psychology research at Western Psychiatry Institute in
President of EEG and Clinical Neuroscience Society. He's the author of multiple publications. His education and training include a PhD in biological psychology at Stony Brook University at New York. His postdoc was in neuropsychiatry at Harvard University School of Medicine, Department of Psychiatry. Please welcome Dr. Salisbury.
Okay, thank you. I just want to be clear, I'm not the director of Western Psych. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about some of the work that we do that's a little bit more on the neuroscience side of things. Psychologist part of me rather than the sort of classic. I have a big voice. Thought disorder. Oh, there you go. Thanks. So what we'll do is, when I was at McLean Hospital 20 years before I moved to Western Psych, and we ran a project as part of a larger group looking at first hospitalized schizophrenia patients. We did a lot of work with people early in their disease course and, of course, with critically ill patients. But we did a lot of over that time. And so what I've done is gone through these interviews and taken out excerpts that sort of highlight kinds of the phenomenology kinds of things we're talking about. So we'll spend a little bit of time talking about thought disorder itself. And then I'll get into the studies we've done with neurophysiology trying to get at what's going on in the brain to cause thought disorder that could be related to thought disorder. So basically this work was funded through mechanisms, so we don't have anything really to disclose. Okay, so schizophrenia, as most of you probably know, is a disintegration of the different facets of personality, and in particular between the mental and the emotional spheres. Okay, it affects about 1% of the population, and a typical onset's in early adulthood. If you look at epidemiologic studies, a lot of times we think, and clinicians think, that schizophrenia is, 20 to 25, something like that, 18 to 25. But if you look at epidemiologic studies, the hospitalization for males is the 50th percentile is about 25, and for women, 7, and for women, it's about 35. So if you look at first hospitalization, it tends to actually to be a little bit later. Okay, and it's, of course, a very costly illness. Over half won't be able to work at all for the rest of their lives. So it really is a lifetime, seriously debilitating disease. And we could talk about various kinds of ways to think about the symptoms, positive symptoms, which generally aren't present, such as hearing voices, paranoia, delusions, disorganized speech, thinking and speech, and then negative symptoms such as anhedonia, intention, working memory problems. So if one looks at social and occupational and outcome, positive symptoms don't really correlate with that when someone comes into the hospital because they're treated fairly well with medications. Okay? Negative symptoms do to some degree, but again, not so much. But it's really the cognitive abnormalities and the thinking abnormalities that correlate the best with social and occupational functioning, and those are the least affected medications that we have to treat patients. So we can think of the work that we're doing is really trying to bring together the biology and the psychology of schizophrenia. So Emil Kraepelin, who talked about dementia praecox, or precocious dementia, said that, really summarizing up his work in his early textbooks, that these considerations force us straight to the assumption that we're concerned here with a palpable pathological process in the brain, and we thus come to the conclusion that in dementia praecox, partial damage to or destruction of cells in the cerebral cortex must probably occur, which mostly brings in its wake a singular permanent impairment of inner life. And Kraepelin believed that there was an endogenous intoxicant that was damaging the brain. And that may or may not be somewhat accurate. Okay? Now, when we think about the psychology, so looking at the symptoms, looking at the phenomenology of the experience, we think of Eugen Bleuler, who came up with the term schizophrenia. And he really said that the fundamental symptoms consist of disturbances of association, so the way that thought worked, and affect or affectivity. Often ideally partially worked out, fragments of ideas are connected in an illogical way to constitute a new idea. Concepts lose their completeness, seem to dance with one or more of their essential components. Indeed, in many cases, they're represented by a few truncated notions. Thus, the process of association often works with mere fragments of ideas and concepts, and this results in association which normal individuals will regard as incorrect, bizarre, and utterly incomprehensible. And so these are really two of the pioneers or iconic figures in schizophrenia research. And they really had two different approaches. Okay, so Kraepelin was in the Alzheimer's school, was looking at brain abnormalities. Bleuler was really more into the phenomenology of the two. And what we'd like to do now, and what the field tries to do, is to bring those two together. So auditory hallucinations, if you think about clinically, these are sort of what I consider the big things that patients suffer when they come into the hospital, when they have to be hospitalized, and what we study. So auditory hallucinations are very common. It can be infrequent and relatively benign to constant and derogatory. Okay, even when patients are treated, you will ask them, you know, are you still being bothered with the voices? And a lot of times they say the voices aren't bothering anymore. And if you follow it up clinically and say, well, are the voices still there or are they gone? Oh, they're there. The medication tones them down and I can ignore them. That's pretty common. Okay, so it's a very debilitating symptom that the patients have. Delusions, of course, strongly held irrational beliefs that influence behavior. They're impervious to rational analysis. And patients may have variable amounts of insight into that. Okay, so we spend some time looking at those. But what I'm particularly interested in, what we'll spend some time doing, is thought disorder. Thought disorder is present to some degree, even when the other symptoms, hearing voices and paranoia, have settled down. And of course, how do you know if someone's thought disordered? Well, someone is typically deemed crazy because they say crazy things, right? It's the content of the speech typically that we focus on. But you need to make the distinction between the content of language versus the form of language. And so people with psychosis and with schizophrenia in particular will also have problems with the form of language in the worst case. But typically what we see clinically and what's remarkable is the content of language. Okay? So what we're going to do now, I just want to go through some interviews. And I'll sort of read through these and then point out what we're talking about. So clinically, you guys may or may not know, but you make the distinction between a regular delusion or a non-bizarre delusion and a bizarre delusion. A bizarre delusion is something that everyone would typically agree is outside the cultural acceptance, okay? So we're talking about bizarre delusions here and ask the patient, did you ever feel that someone or something outside yourself was controlling your thoughts or actions against your will? No. So we follow that up. Sometimes people think that Satan or God or some mysterious force has some control over what they do. The patient says, oh, I misread an article about Reagan, former President Reagan, Star Wars, how it could read computers. I thought somebody in Cambridge, was it somebody in Boston, was using it to read my mind. So you thought someone could read your mind? Yes. Well, did you ever feel that certain thought that were not your own were taken out of your head or put into your head? No. So this person could read your mind, but that was it. That was it. It didn't have any control over you. No. And then later on, we're talking about hallucinations. Okay, you've never seen anything that was actually not there that other people couldn't see. Have you ever had strange sensations on your body or on your skin? Yes, on my skin I had tingling. How often did that happen? Oh, it happened quite often before I started hearing voices. Okay, so there was no reason for the tingling? I thought I was being controlled by someone in Cambridge with a Star Wars satellite. Okay, so this is the same person that was reading your mind? Yes. All right, so he's talking about his delusion. He has a bizarre delusion of control through satellites and someone in Cambridge. He's talking about his hallucinations. Okay, but what you may notice is that when we talked about the hallucinations, it was delusions of control. Okay, and earlier on, he denied that he was being controlled. And so again, there's a certain amount of inconsistency in there, in the history that you get from the person as you're talking. And he's not being malicious and trying to hide things, but it's just trying to get through and get into that real underlying experience that they've had. You know, sometimes you have to ask repetitive questions and ask them in different ways, but there's actually a little bit of thought disorder in there from that lack of consistency. Very mild, though. So this is another patient, and this is more clearly thought disordered, and has a neologism, which is a new word that he's invented, or a new phrase that he's invented to explain something. And most of this interview is trying to figure out what he's talking about. So the patient had come in because he didn't actually chop his hand off, but he attempted to cut it off and had a pretty serious wound from trying to cut his hand off. So tell me a little bit about what brought you to McLean's. You said you tried to cut your hand off. You didn't want to fight your girlfriend or God. That's right. Can you tell me a little bit about what you mean by that? Well, you got to know how first think goes, I guess. Huh? First think. First think? Yeah. First thing you, someone thinks you. Now we're starting to get somewhat disorganized. I'm not quite following. First think is doing what you think first. Uh-huh. And does that have to do with why you cut your hand off? Yeah. So that was just what popped into your mind and so you did it? No. I don't do first things very well. That's just first thing from God. First thing from God. Did God tell you to cut your hand off? I think he would have been happy if I had. Mm-hmm. Why? So I didn't have to fight him. Mm-hmm. Why would you have to fight God? What do you mean when you say fight God? Well, I don't know why I'd have to fight God. It just got reversed back on me. I had the choice to fight God or fight my girlfriend, and I didn't do either. I just sat back down in the chair, so that meant I was fighting God instead of my girlfriend. Mm-hmm. On a first think basis. Okay, so we really have no idea what he's talking about. Okay? I really don't know what first think is. He can't explain it, you know, and you can see the interviewer is a little flustered, trying to sort of explain and push on it. And so, again, this is a pretty good example of a neologism, but also thought disorder. He's very disorganized and really can't say why he did it, even explain it in a not necessarily rational way, but in a coherent way. This is a patient that is the most disorganized that you ever see. He actually has word salad. Okay, and this patient did lose his leg. So he has an artificial prosthetic leg. He worked as an electrician and either got electrocuted or got hit by lightning, had to lose his leg. So the interviewer is asking some of the standard questions on the SCID, the Structured Clinical Interview for DSM. Do you ever feel that part of your body change or stop working? Let's say after phantom pains. After phantom pains? After phantom pains that left. The body will continue abruptly. And how, when you say your body continues abruptly, what do you mean? How is it different from anyone else's? Let's see. I have one ring that doesn't include meatballs. And, of course, the interviewer is completely, flummoxed there, you know. So you have a ring that doesn't include meatballs? Include meatballs, spaghetti. And what does that have to do with your body? Whether it was something by the limestone or... So the interview is trying to get him back. So you have a ring that doesn't include meatballs? Correct. All right. Now, you mentioned something about you have a dinosaur rump. Correct. That's information. And how do you know that? Well, Lexington, it's a town near Boston, has it on the records as well. But this is in your body that you're talking about. What makes you think that's... It's a formation of rock, and whether or not there's steel sand within it, at the meatball, or the formation of your muscle tones. Okay, so you feel there's something wrong with your body right now. Well, the mean temperature of 15 degrees Fahrenheit. So interviewer's doing their best to try and get the information out. Okay. So what's your understanding of the ring that doesn't include meatballs and all this? Well, when you go from 18,700 miles to Italy, that's where it's from. Where what's from? The ring in particular. Can you tell me a little about the ring? I'm not quite following. And I'm looking at the understanding of machinery's practices, updated reversions of the equipment thereof, and how speed elapsed, and we're very much ahead, but we're still antiquated as far as forming an answer. So the interviewer pretty much gives up, moves on, and says, let me ask you, do you ever hear things that other people might not hear, like noises or music or voices? Well, I have jewelry to cover that. You have jewelry to cover that, and fiber optics, yes. Okay, so very, very, very highly disorganized. This is a very rare patient, most disorganized patient I've ever seen. But there's something about the rings protecting against the voices. There's some sort of a delusional thing in there. But very, very difficult to understand what he's talking about. And yet, if you just met him and you just chat, he's not disorganized, but when he's trying to sort of describe what's on, he's really, really exceptionally disorganized. Everything, again, is sort of like Bloiler said, everything is in these little truncated notions. He called me up one time, and he said, Dr. Salisbury, I'm waiting for the pencil. And it must have taken me 5 minutes. I said, is this so-and-so? Yes. Okay. Are you supposed to have paper and pencil tests in the lab today? Yes. Okay, good, gotcha. But I'm waiting for the pencil was his way of saying that. So again, it was just really difficult to articulate, very truncated. Okay. Okay. So this is getting into homography. All right. And I think I did this. I did this interview, and I couldn't think on my feet fast enough not to define the word he was having problems with, without using the word again. So it's sort of my bad. But this patient was saying he was depressed. So why were you depressed at the time? He says, girlfriend committed suicide. Were you with her? No. Did you find her? No. All right, no. Did this come as a complete surprise? Yes. So it was really very difficult for you. Okay, during that time, did you lose interest in things? What do you mean interest? Well, I'm talking about a time period when you were feeling really depressed and you had less interest in things than usual. I don't have any interest. Okay, but back then? I don't have any bonds, I don't have any stocks, you didn't ask me that. I'm like, no, we're not talking about money, that kind of interest, right? Do you have any interest in life at that time? No, I don't have oil wells, concerns, or anything like that. And then he sort of gets it, you know, I read books, but they don't do me any good, they don't make me money, okay? And so, again, interest is a homograph, it's a word that has multiple meanings. And when someone has thought disorder, and this is really what our sort of starting point is, when someone has thought disorder, words of multiple meanings, or homophones when we're speaking, are particular places where the thought can go awry. And that's sort of the basis of the research that we've been doing with the neurophysiology. I'm just going to skip over this one. Okay, so if we think about this loose associations, the way things go. We need to think a little bit about the way semantic memory is laid out. And so basically, we can think of it sort of its old school from the 70s, the Collins and Loftus model. You have a concept stored in semantic memory like red, and there are various things that are associated directly with the color red or indirectly, okay? And this distance, the semantic distance, okay, is how quickly this spread of activation in semantic network has to occur. So if you think of association tests, things that are closer that you think of more quickly than things that are further apart, that take longer to activate. Okay? If we think about what's going on and get this into a little more sophisticated system, we could think about semantic memory feeding up into some sort of a working memory, in this case, verbal working memory, which modulates back down. Okay? And then this information somehow feeds over. So we're interested in these links between working memory, a verbal working memory, and semantic memory, and of course, how information, this feature level information, gets into semantic memory. Okay? So essentially, if you're talking about language, you're talking about at this level, phonology, the sound code, or orthography, the written code, getting translated into the semantic memory stores themselves. You may hear about the dual route theory into semantic memory, okay? That's phonology and written. And then we're interested in schizophrenia. Is everything up here? What's going on down here? Where can we find abnormalities? So when you read a word, such as the word red here, so the stem is very thorny. He was careful as he pruned the full red blooms. When the word red goes on, of course, again, we said there's a spread of activation, and then the colors from sort of warm to hot are how much the spread of activation turns those nodes on. So again, when that happens, that word red is going to go up and feed into working memory as well, which is going to have an inhibitory process that works. It takes a quarter of a second for that information in working memory to then go back to modulate and turn things off in semantic memory. Okay, so this comes from a lot of cognitive literature from the 70s, 80s, and this is basically pretty good evidence to suggest that this is how it works. A lot of it's based on reaction times. So if we could imagine when you see the word red, there's some spread of activation. I couldn't figure out how to make this in three dimensions, so just imagine this is three-dimensional here. It's a cone or something. And the question that we want to ask, and we want to frame it, is when people with schizophrenia, is the problem that they have with over-associations, loose associations, and things like that because there's too much activation at a very basic level in semantic memory? Is it that there's too much spread of activation, and that may be related to the fact that the verbal working memory doesn't inhibit things like it should in that later course. And so we have an earlier course and a later course of activity that we want to try and probe. So we came up with what we call the activation maintenance model, and it's about 750 milliseconds is about the duration of the initial bottom-up burst in semantic activity. And information online after that for a second or longer, it has to go into your verbal working memory stores. Okay? So the question was, do we have too much activation in schizophrenia, which decays down past the initial buffer of semantic memory and isn't stored in verbal working memory and kept online? So that at long essays, when you ask people with schizophrenia to keep information online for a long period of time, their behavior gets sort of random because they get things. They can't keep it online and use it. But theoretically, this would propose that when you look very early, within, say, 200 or 300 milliseconds after people with schizophrenia have a word, they would actually show too much activation. So there's sort of a time course where initially there's too much, later on there's too little. Okay? So we were trying to get at this using neurophysiology. So what we do is we record the EEG. Okay? We use caps like this. They have little sensors. Each one of these sensors is an electrode where we could record the activity. I think Dr. Moore said he gave a talk on P300 last week, so I guess you were here for the last one. I'm not going to spend too much time talking about technique, but what we do is we record the brain's activity in milliseconds, so in time. This cap here, hopefully this isn't the only thing you remember from the talk, but this cap's on backwards. That should be in the back of the head. And it's much too small for her. This is from a group at Penn, and the photographer thought the red cap actually looked really pretty with her blue eyes. So he made her wear that one. But whoever put it on backwards. Okay. But what we do is we record the electricity from the scalp through all of these electrodes as someone does a task. And we can record the EEG like one would in, you know, classic neurology. But what we're doing is we're presenting stimuli over and over again, and then we're extracting out little parts of the EEG that relate just to the stimulus processing. And so we do that by averaging many, many trials over time. Things that are related to hearing a sound or reading a word occur at about the same time, so you can extract that from the random background of other biological signals. Okay? So when one looks at language, there's a particular brain wave that you can get. This is time zero here is when a word is presented. And this would be the response of the brain to a particular word. In this case, this N400, which is a negative response at about 400 milliseconds, subjects are seeing these one at a time. I take my coffee with cream end, and then we're looking at the brain's response to the last word. The last word would be, I take my coffee with cream and sugar, or I take my coffee with cream and dog. Okay, dog doesn't fit in with the context of that sentence, right? It doesn't have a high close probability, they call it. It doesn't fit. And when that happens, the brain generates a very large N400 to something that doesn't fit with context. So another way of thinking about that and using this as a tool is to say we could use this N400 response to probe the contents of verbal working memory. Okay, so if we think that patients with schizophrenia have a problem in verbal working memory, okay, then they should be getting maybe larger N400 to words that should fit with context. Okay, if at that long, over a second stimulus asynchrony or SOA, they have problems maintaining information. So again, what we want to think about is disordered thought. When you get to the point of word salad, it certainly seems random. When you have more milder thought disorder, is it random? Is it uncontrolled activation of links and semantic stores? Or rather, is it actually really very rule following? Maybe patients with schizophrenia have a problem maintaining and using context. And so when things are activated in semantic memory in a bodily way, they always follow the strongest association because they can't use context to tell them you should go weak link. You should go in the more subordinate path. Okay? So that was sort of our starting point. We used homographs to get at that. Okay? So what we did was we came up with some very simple tasks to start. And these are presented slow, about 1 per second. And we said things like the door was shut or the panel was oak. Now, panel's a homograph, and its dominant meaning is a panel of wood, but its subordinate meaning is like a jury, okay? So the panel that will sit on your dissertation, right, or your boards, right, that you have, okay? So what you can see in healthy subjects is when they look at the response to this last word, something that really doesn't make sense, okay, you get a large N400. Okay, when you look at the door was shut, you get a small N400. But when you look at the panel was oak, which makes perfect sense, and the panel was voting, which makes perfect sense, you still get this graded N400 response. And what that does is that actually works out and tracks the probability of that particular association in usage, even if you match the probability of this coming up when you tell someone what you associate with panel. So this is a weak associate of panel. This is by definition a weak associate because it's a subordinate meaning. You still get this graded response. And what we suggested was that in people with schizophrenia, when they hit these ambiguous words, this one, the subordinate one, they will not be able to process, okay, because they've already pre-selected that strong link and followed that link without any lockdown control. So what we can see is in schizophrenia, if you just look at the errors they make, if we just normalize it by the, they're not so bad at unambiguous words saying it makes sense. We ask if these sentences make sense or not. But they have a real problem with subordinate words. Okay? They make a lot more errors. And so do controls. It's difficult. But when we look at that graded brain response, this is a different sample of controls. Again, we see an unambiguous word, a dominant word, a subordinate word, and then an unrelated word. Okay? Controls are very graded. But when we look at schizophrenia, that subordinate homograph, okay, which makes perfect sense, has a larger response than even a word that's not related at all. Okay? So we spent a lot of time sort of probing this and looking at this, trying to get at sort of the structure of semantic memory and what was going on in schizophrenia in terms of the train of thought. That's really what we were trying to get at. So the question is this a problem where there may be something in memory itself, the semantic memory, where weak links simply aren't maintained in schizophrenia? Okay? Essentially, their semantic memory is abnormal. Or is it a problem with utilizing or storing context in working memory or some combination of both? So one thing we did was, because we wanted to look at fast presentation rates, we did just that. We did very fast presentations, very slow presentations, now just word pairs. Okay, so homograph and an associate. What we see in controls, in the slow rate, again, we see this graded response. Okay, colors have changed, but unambiguous, dominant, subordinate, unrelated are schizophrenics, very little, except the subordinate one, again, has the large response. Okay, so that seems to be pretty consistent. But when we sped up, what we saw was in controls, in healthy participants, the dominant and the unambiguous word were very similar. The subordinate had much more response, but the unrelated was still bigger. And this is pretty much a left hemisphere response. Left hemisphere likes to pick the strongest associate. And so the right hemisphere is what sort of keeps the subordinate stuff online. But what you can see when we speed things up, even though the response is small in patients, now the unrelated word has the biggest response, and the subordinate in the middle, just sort of like it is with the controls. So to some extent, even though it's not perfectly normal, when we speed things up, we get a more normal response in the schizophrenics, okay? When we really focus on what's going on in the bottom-up part, the early part of the semantic memory, one of the things that we did was we used masking, sort of subliminal presentation. So a classic lexical decision task, doctor, and then you see nurse, what are you doing? And there might be another word over here, like ORP. All you're doing is saying whether the word's real or not, okay? You're not saying if they're associated or anything. You make a lexical decision. Is it in your dictionary, in your lexicon? So when you see nurse that follows doctor, you're faster to process nurse as a real word. That's called, what is that called? That's called semantic priming, okay? So faster reaction time. So the question is, what happens when you mask this? All right, when you mask that, you're not consciously aware of it. Do you still see priming? Okay, and we did this at very fast presentation rates to try and get into that early part of that initial activation we were looking at. And what we found is that actually only the schizophrenics showed priming, so they still use that information in semantic memory, okay, whereas controls didn't. And the amount that the schizophrenics got faster in this very they primed in this fast presentation rate, was correlated with their thought disorder. So the worst patients, okay, in terms of their, it's hard for me to see at this angle. Okay, so this is the PANS total, okay, and their positive scale, okay. Their thought disturbance, seeing all these correlations, okay? Actually, depression was a little harder to figure out, and SAPS, which is scale for the assessment of positive symptoms, the anti-racist scale. So essentially, when we look at what's going on during this subliminal thing and getting an idea of what's going on at the bottom up, patients that are very thought disordered only appear to have overactivation of what's called hyperpriming of semantic memory. And you can think of that biologically as the gain being up. Ties in with some of the ideas about what dopamine does, okay, but that the gain of these things is up too high. Okay, so we'll skip over that for the urges. So what happens now when we go to the opposite extreme and we give a lot of context? Okay, so we have said read at their own pace two sentences for these homographs. Okay, and for example, for bank, it could be the robber ran from the building holding bags of money. The alarms went off. Well, bank means one thing there. Or the alligator lunged from the river. It dragged an antelope down the sandy ledge. Well, bank means another thing there. But we're giving really strong biasing to tell you what bank means, okay? So we're giving a lot of information that's going to push you towards the dominant or the subordinate meaning, okay? So what happens in healthy controls, well, we prime them towards the dominant, and then we give them a lexical decision task later with the word bank, which they've never seen in that description, right? The subordinate meaning of bank gets a large N400 as expected. But when we push them towards the subordinate prime, then the dominant gets the large N400. Okay, is that clear? Just basically use the context as just like you would expect. Okay. What happens in the patients, though, is neither gets a big response. Okay. So the patients, one thing that's happened that's good is they don't have dominant bias. So the subordinate response, remember we said before, when you just let them go their own way, they don't seem to process subordinate one. In this experiment, they didn't have that bias, but they didn't benefit really in addition to that from the context. Okay? So this is really sort of suggesting that the context is not being utilized by the patients. Okay. I'm going to skip over this one. All right, let me go to this one. So we talked about using context. So what we did was we had another experiment, again, where what we did was we wanted people to develop an expectancy contrary to semantic associations, okay? So we told them when they see a specific category, okay, like, for example, a part of a body, so body would be the category, then the second word is probably going to be a kitchen utensil, okay? So instead of expecting arm or leg or whatever it would be, they were told to expect spoon or fork or cup, something like that. Okay. So now what we have is we have this sort of bottom-up semantic association in opposition to your top-down expectancy. So there should be feedback from frontal lobes, one presumes, saying one thing to expect this, and then bottom-up information in semantic memory saying this is what's associated, right? This is what's close. And then we gave them 10 trials, you know, to implicitly learn the rule, and then we tested them later, and we had a whole bunch of trials. So first we'll look at the behavior. If you look at the reaction time priming, when words were associated for healthy subjects, they still responded to quickly in terms of reaction time, okay? When we look at our schizophrenic patients, again, they still responded to the related words without difference as a function of whether it was expected or not. But in healthies, when you looked at expectancy here versus sort of ones that they weren't trained on this side, you could see that it was faster for unrelated words. Okay, so you had facilitation of the reaction to something that wasn't related by a top-down expectancy. Okay, so information had to go from the top to the bottom. But if you look at the patients, they did the same thing. Okay. So patients who generally are unable to use that context can, in fact, use it when you give them some training to do it. Okay. But as a matter of course, as a matter of default, patients won't use that information. Okay. We don't know why. We want to figure out why. But the information seems to be getting into the verbal working memory. It's not a question of them having default verbal working memory, which is actually what that model I put up earlier, we said the problem with their working memory, with maintenance. It's not a problem with maintenance. It can get in there. It's a problem with utilization. They're not using the information. It's a strategic thing. Okay. Now, if we look at the N400, what we can see is for the untrained pairs, straight old semantic priming, we get a nice N400 for an unrelated category in controls. And when we train them to expect something unrelated, it flips over. So we actually got the brain wave to flip over. Okay? Our schizophrenics, for the untrained words, again, they're not even showing an N400 effect. Okay? But with training, they also flipped over their brainwave. Okay? So this was actually not what we expected at all. Okay? But it's actually sort of interesting. What it suggests is that there are definitely problems in semantic memory in schizophrenia, but with training, okay, that they can actually use that information. So healthy subjects showed the large N400 effect to the untrained, semantically unrelated words, and the well controls also showed a reversal of the N400. Patients showed very little N400, as I said, and they do show a reversal. Okay. And I'm just going to skip over that. So what does this mean? So we know that patients with thought disorder, to summarize this, right, they do show hyperpriming. There is a problem in the basic semantic memory with patients of things being too active. And you can sort of think of that as swamping your consciousness with associates that really don't have anything to do with what you're talking about. Okay, so there's a problem at that level. And the question is, how is this real world behavior affected by a bias to jump tracks towards strong associates? Right, so that's a question that we ask. Is there some way that we can reduce ambiguity in language for patients? Because they would benefit from that. Because we know that when you're just having discourse with patients and talking, they're gonna switch tracks on you, and there are logical and sort of rule-following points where patients do switch tracks, okay? And when you start to think about it, there are a lot of homophones in English, okay? Quite a lot. Question is, how do we reduce that lexical ambiguity? How can context be maximized to provide the greatest benefit? Because we know that patients can actually store context, can store the information and use it, but for some reason they don't. So it's really a utilization deficit. And the question where we want to go is to say, under what conditions can they freely utilize context? Why don't they generally do that, and how do we improve it so that we can improve the general behavior? Thank you. So there's certainly time for questions. Yes? Excellent. So there's two kinds of, So the question was, what's my opinion essentially of training programs that are being sort of marketed, and there's sort of a rage now, or a fad, one might say, for schizophrenia. Okay, so there are two different kinds of training programs. One is a cognitive-based, and the other is really sort of sensory-based. And the sensory ones sort of come out of the dyslexia literature. And so we talked a little bit about phonological decoding earlier, right? How do you get into semantic memory? And it turns out that children with dyslexia have problems encoding phonemes and with categorical perception. So everybody's voice is different, right? And yet we all want to hear ah and ba the same in terms of decoding it. And so training programs were developed, and it really does show that if you can improve the ability to classify phonemes in people with dyslexia, you have improvements in their symptoms. And people have been thinking about whether sensory abnormalities, schizophrenia, actually underlie a lot of the cognitive things. And whether you can train people with cognitive remediation in schizophrenia and social, functional, sort of, can you make people with schizophrenia better at recognizing emotions? So the answer is, yeah, they do work. The cognitive rehabilitation, the sort of social and occupational rehabilitation, they really do work. Really, the ones that work are really intensive. And they take over a year to get through the whole protocol, but they do help. The ones with the sensory training, we're not sure about. Some people claim that they do work, and as far as I know, there's only one study that wasn't funded by one of the companies that looked at a brain wave and did show improvement. So we've been actually trying to set something up to do combined cognitive and sensory training in early onset, well, not early onset, but first episode patients to see if we can improve some of their brain waves to get at whether this really works. But so I was really skeptical at first, but they probably will benefit, but we don't know really much. But it probably does work. Yeah, and there's good evidence to suggest that the cognitive remediation does work. So, yes.
With your model, have you tried drug probe studies? You mentioned dopamine, so on.
No, we haven't. No. Most patients that we see are medicated, and again, it's various kinds of first and second generation medications. And so we don't really have a good idea of what the medications do. Some of my colleagues were giving small doses of amphetamine to the patients and looking at some other measures that they thought would improve it. And so the problem with that is it's really hard to convince a psychiatrist that they should give low doses of, you know, amphetamines or strattera or something like that to patients. But we haven't done that in terms of the language stuff.
Has anyone tried that in controls?
Yeah.
Amphetamine?
Yeah, I'm not. The answer is yes, but I'd have to actually go look at the literature to tell you. But yes, those kinds of studies happen. But I'm not entirely sure if it's been in concert with the EEG measures or the brainwave measures, or whether it's just reaction time. I'd have to look. So.
Very nice presentation, Dr. Salisbury.
Thank you.
I was wondering if you can comment about the course of progression of schizophrenics. Some you could say, are relatively sharp in their younger years, and they do well in school. And then suddenly the symptoms start developing, and their processing changes. If you could comment about how maybe the structure of the brain changes,
mm-hmm.
and perhaps if there's any changes within, like, the entorhinal cortex, which is kind of integrates some of that information.
Oh, that's a good question, yeah. Okay, so the question is about sort of the early course and you know, is it really a precipitous, you know, onset, and how does that look? So in the last 10 to 20 years, the sort of field schizophrenia has gone from this perinatal static encephalopathy to one that includes a progressive course. And so I'm sure you're even being trained in the notion of a prodrome, right? So if you look, there are different courses for cognitive decline and then symptom onset. So probably neuropsychological functioning gets hit earliest. So if you look at people before the first break during the prodrome, the neurocognitive decline seems to kick in first. Then there's social and occupational impairments kick in, and then symptom emergence. And all of this is occurring before full-blown psychosis. So when we look at the brain, what's the underlying mechanism? Most likely, it's a disease of dendrotoxicity. It's a disease of synapses and dendrites. And so if you look at postmortem of people with schizophrenia, they have less dendritic spines. They have fewer synapses. The volume of the cortex is reduced. The number of pyramidal cells, the density is increased. So the number of cells is the same. The pyramidal cells in the cortex, that's the main processing unit, are not dying, but they're shrinking. Okay, and they have fewer synapses. So it's really a disorder of dendrites, and I refer to it as dendrotoxicity, which comes out of the idea of excitatory amino acid degeneration or toxicity from the late 90s. So that's pretty much what's going on. In terms of entorhinal cortex, I don't know how well studied that is. Hippocampus, cingulate, the cortex are always hot areas that people look at, prefrontal cortex, temporal cortex, sort of areas that are polymodal, that are connected with different sensory systems. Those seem to be hit first. In our work at Harvard, we had spent quite a lot of time doing MRI, and it's very clear that the left hemisphere, particularly in the temporal lobe, gets hit first, and there's cortical gray matter reduction in that area. Over time, it spreads across the brain. It gets worse in the prefrontal cortex. It gets worse bilaterally. But it's really a disorder where if you look, if you use MRI, and you do SPM, which is a voxel by voxel comparison, if you do those kinds of statistical analyses, what you'll see is that the entire brain in schizophrenia from first episode to the first few years loses about 2 to 3% of gray matter. But if you break it up into the lobes, or even more specifically, the frontal lobes and the temporal lobes lose about 7% and 7 to 8%, and the rest of the brain loses quite less. You can imagine it has to be less than 2%, right? So it's really a disorder that really hits those particular areas and frontal temporal connectivity. So in a lot of ways, it's mainly a cortical disorder, although it's not to say there aren't subcortical abnormalities in there, particularly in hippocampus and limbic system. So I'm not entirely sure about entorhinal cortex, though. Yeah, Dr. Moore. So that's my other talk that's a little more anatomical.
My question was a follow-up to the comment here about looking at neurotransmitters. I don't know if you have a comment on this idea, but the P300 is dependent on an adequate supply of dopamine. In other words, when you've got too little dopamine, such as in Parkinson's disease, the P300 is weak. And yet in schizophrenia, the opposite is true. There's too much dopamine activity. And I wonder, can you tie the two things together?
Yeah.
The N400 in schizophrenia, where it's too much dopamine, and P300, where you need a lot of dopamine. And I can't tie them together myself, but I wonder what you think about
you.
That.
Yeah, so the question is, you know, the pretty much all psychotics work by targeting dopamine receptors, either directly or indirectly, right? So you got to hit that D2 receptor somehow. So that was something that was really confusing for the field for a long time, and certainly for me when we were talking about this, because all of the things we're talking about, this too much spread of activation, a reduced gain, things like that, or too little dopamine. That's what they reflect, but not too much dopamine, and yet all the medications that we give the patients are to knock dopamine down. So there was a series of papers, and the person I think that was leading that was, his name's Anthony Grace. He's at Pittsburgh. What he proposed, and his name comes to mind, he might not be the first to propose this, but I think he's certainly the one who championed it, and it sort of makes sense of all of this, is that there's a reciprocal relationship between dopamine in the caudate and ganglia and in the prefrontal cortex. And so the idea is that, you know, you have two pathways of dopamine coming up, and the one that we're concerned with is the midbrain one that goes to the basal ganglia. I'm forgetting the exact name of that one. And what happens is there's too much dopamine in the caudate, but what that does is that causes a reciprocal or a negative feedback with dopamine in the prefrontal cortex, such that actually the disorder is too little dopamine in the cortex. So it's not just the disorder of too much dopamine everywhere. It's a disorder of too much dopamine in the basal ganglia, which in turn causes too little dopamine in the cortex. And there's quite a bit of evidence that suggests that actually is the way that feedback loop between cortical and cortical structures work. So that explains a lot. Really, it's sort of a missing key, because so much of the models that we talk about would posit little gain, not too much gain.
Has work been done already looking at the difference between negative symptom, schizophrenia, and positive, because the idea of the negative symptoms is that it's too little dopamine in the schizophrenic in the frontal area.
Yes, and so the rule, so as a heuristic, I think you're probably safe if you say that, well, negative symptoms are typically prefrontal hypoactivation. I think you're right. And positive symptoms are typically temporal lobe hyperactivation. Now, the hypoactivation could also be of inhibitory stuff. So you could have a disinhibition, right, which is the problem. You have too little inhibition, okay? But typically, if you could think, I think it's okay, you know, take it with a grain of thought, but as a rule of thumb, if you think negative symptoms, working memory problems are really prefrontal cortex. Positive symptoms, delusions, paranoia, hearing voices, of course, have a lot more to do with what's going on in the temporal lobe. And it's really the frontotemporal connectivity that's what's abnormal here. Yeah, I think that's probably a good way to think about it, sort of, you know, it's a heuristic to understand what's going on in those two areas. But I'm a pretty firm believer that the temporal lobe is more positive symptoms. The frontal lobe is more negative symptoms. Yes? Last question, I guess.
Whether or not cognitive restructuring adds a lot of value therapeutically, like just what are your thoughts? Because you're suggesting it's more of a top-down or frontotemporal connectivity issue.
Right. So I'm not sure what you mean by cognitive restructuring.
Well, education.
So. Yeah. No, I think that the question that was asked a little bit earlier about these sort of cognitive remediation programs and strategic things, yeah, I think they do have value, and I think there's empirical evidence to suggest that they do. Now, personally, I would want to try and get at the underlying mechanism and maybe figure out a medication or some sort of other intervention, whether it's TMS or some sort of stimulation. One thing that's going on, which you might find interesting, clinically sort of research is a different technique called TAC. It's TMS, but it uses an AC current. And the idea is that I believe it's the positive side causes activation and the negative side causes deactivation. I'm not entirely sure I have that backwards, but one side of the pole, the cathode or the anode, causes activation and deactivation. And so what they do with people with schizophrenia is they're trying to boost up activity in the prefrontal cortex and turn down activity in the temporal cortex using the technique. And it's still really very experimental. But that one actually sort of shows some promise. It may restore some of the balance in that particular system. There's definitely good evidence to suggest that the anterior parts of the brain in schizophrenia are hypoactive. And relatively speaking, against a brain that's more hypoactive, the posterior parts of the brain are hyperactive in schizophrenia, as if they're trying to compensate for the frontal lobes that are online or aren't doing their job well. So,
thank you, everyone, for coming.
Okay, thank you,
Professor.